Webinar on Introduction to Artificial Intelligence, Aruna Engineering College by the Department of Humanities and Sciences. So it is the need of the hour, needless to say, everybody knows, but it may be new to the first year students of our college. So artificial intelligence and machine learning takes momentum. It is talked everywhere throughout the globe. And the future is full of artificial intelligence. It has paved its way in all fields, right from automobiles, buildings, and many other fields. Needless to say, information technology also. So students must have some access to this artificial intelligence, neural networks, machine learning, and all. Then later on, they can pursue any one particular topic during their higher semesters. So in this circumstance, the Humanities and Sciences Department has initiated in inviting the eminent personalities in Dinesh Kumar Subramaniam of Dream Technology and Srimati Meenakshi Priya Subramaniam from Dream Technology. So it is a nice day to all make use of the people, the experts who are from Dream Technology, who have got some lot of experience in this technology, make use of it. So it is proud to invite Mrs. Meenakshi Priya, our proud alumni of Aruna Engineering College. So make use of the knowledge from them. Have a nice day. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me, voice? Hello.
Yes,
sir, you are audible.
Okay. Now I handed over the session to guests to share their valuable thoughts to first years. Please, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. My honorable professors and my dear juniors, I would say, I'm seriously very excited to be part of this session where I'm getting to interact with my dear juniors and where I was 15 years back. And today you guys are there. So delighted to be meeting everybody here in this live session. And good morning to everyone. First, I would like to represent myself as an alumni of Arunai, then as a CEO of Dream Technology. So as an alumni, I would like to share a few things with my juniors now, which I carried as part of my lessons from the college till date, right? It kind of resonates in my back of my mind and keeps telling me any point in struggle, wherever I face, right? These are few lessons which I carry always. So Asi sir has asked me to give a motivating session, but I would really like to only share my experience, what I have carried so far, and what the college has rendered, right? So irrespective number of lessons, and there is commendable administration help that I always had from the college. And when I like to talk about few things to you, right, I would talk about three basic stuff which the college has told me and always has educated me in. First thing is, right, build an ecosystem. RC sir he was my HOD when I was in computer science department few years back. Aziz sir used to be my HOD, and it is very essential for everybody, be it a male or a female, to build an ecosystem. And that building up an ecosystem stuff, right, we should really cultivate it, is what I see. Be it friends, our parents, our relatives, our fellow beings, right, we would always need to be part of a system wherein we give to them the most what we can in any possible way. For instance, be it a help to the friend, or when you're economically sound, right, be it an economic offering to the society or anything for that matter, right? Building up an ecosystem is our responsibility, and which would really let us thrive further and look forward for a good society as well. So that's number one. And having said building up an ecosystem, right, I would also like to talk about my experience in the college, how we built an ecosystem. The Arunai Center, I think, right, that was constructed the year when we were about to pass out. And we formulated the whole structure of organization committee. We, with the help of RCSR, we nominated few members, which had vice president and presidents across each and every department. And from there, we started formulating many events in the college. So the leadership strategy of building up, giving power to the empowerment to the student community, right? It's very much in Arunai, I understand. But again, we should really make use of that opportunity and build up a very nice ecosystem and learn wherever it is possible for us. For instance, right, I groomed up to be an person from a very small town. And when I came to Arunai as a hostler, right, seriously, this building up of ecosystem really helped, wherein it's a new place for me where there was no hand-holding like you guys, right? And even with the warden, with the watchman, with the teacher and the friends, right? So everything really helped me groom up there. And that culture really carried forward during my experience in IT companies as well. And then later on enabled me look forward to what I want to do in life. And then we started up this company. So I'll come to that particular part later. So that's one key important thing. Second thing, what I wanted to tell you is never ever give up. If you think something is right, please stand by, because we are the only person who can talk on behalf of us the most, right? So, and ideally the thought process, what we have in our mind, right, I basically assimilated multiple number of times and see, okay, it is right? So if it is right, let me do it. Give it a try. One life. There is no second life as something which I don't believe in. So one life, right? So just give it a try to whatever you think that is possible for you. And even impossible things, right, we would actually have to try it out and then see the outcome of it. It'd be really, really nice, because it's all because of your own efforts, right, you put in place, not with someone's push. So those two things are very valuable lessons is what I would really see as. And third important thing, right, embrace change. For instance, today I see you guys have been in the classrooms for a long time, and then now we moved to the online world, right? So that's one big change we are adapting to. And from our professors and the lecturers who now we speak and talk, right, we can really see how they have kind of adapted from no cell. They did not even have mobile phones at that time. When I was graduating from college, that was the time when we had the small phone in place with no touch and all, the keyboard, pad phones, right? So embrace change wherever it is, even in life or in the professional career, and then take up the opportunities and give the best out of you. You will really be wonderful, and the upcoming future is all yours. So that's what I like to say as an alumni of the college. And second, in any questions so far, or am I in the pace where you can understand? Can I proceed, sir?
Can proceed, Minaj Priya. All our first years, they are having another sequence of event, then they come out with having the question and answer session, I think.
So. Okay, sir. So second, as an CEO of this company, right, Dream Technology, I like to walk you through what we are doing there in place, right, and how things evolved, right? I know sir would have really briefed about the presentation, really explains, the invitation really explains of what I've been doing all my life. So I'm not restricting it to it, and just I'm going to take you all through our company's profile here, so that you'll all be aware of what we are doing, right? So this is our logo, Dream Technology. And we started this company in 2016. We started with 4 people in the company, and now we are almost 32 people in the company now. And whatever we specialize in, we do out of artificial intelligence. That's why this topic of introduction to artificial intelligence is also in play now. We are put up in Tiruvannamalai, Chennai. My juniors, my college faculties, everybody are like kind of always welcome to visit our company anytime. And these are few offerings we work on. And I understand it's all for the first years, right? So we are an IT company who basically have core as artificial intelligence and thrive every snippet of automation or website building or web application building, ERPs and CRM construction or digital marketing around this artificial intelligence space. And so we see that it is a future, right? And we have few set of focus also that Dinesh will touch base in the further discussion. And as an alumni, right, I would also, these are two categories of offering what we do, consulting and products. As an alumni, right, I would also want to tell you all one important thing. Dinesh is my sibling, my elder brother. And I will invite him to this particular session on the community's behalf. Invite you, Dinesh, for taking up this for the further sessions. So thank that's all I have from my side.
Actually, thanks for the intro.
Yeah. So over to Dinesh. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the proposal. Yeah, thank you very much for the professors and Aruna Engineering College and Meenakshi for giving me this opportunity to take you through the journey of artificial intelligence. Okay, so AI is a passion for me. So I've been researching in AI for the last 16, 17 years. So it all started in my undergrad where I started dabbling with AI in my second year, I think. Okay, so from then on, I got hold with AI, data mining, and whatever it is that has been through the life. I've done few things here and there with respect to AI, few papers in data mining. So that's the start. So that's where it starts. The reason I'm mentioning my AI journey started in undergrad is because like you guys are like undergrad students who are right now getting into the second year. Second year is where it kicked in for me. Okay, first year is all about getting accustomed to the environment, getting to know people because we always like come from some other place to a new college. So getting to know the places, the people, adapting yourself. The second year is where you get into the josh, like you'll get into the mood to learn new things, explore and set up a path. So you'll take your life's journey in that path though. So that's the second year is very important. With that, like I'll start with the presentation. I'll focus right now on AI. And later on, once the presentation is over, I'll tell you like how to go about learning, basically. So I see there is a huge divide between the academia and industry. Okay, there is a huge divide between the academia and the industry because academia takes a particular goal and then makes the student go through a particular path. Industry, whereas it's expecting a different goal from the students. I will always like to act as a bridge between this academia and industry. For that, in the past and now we are doing few things. I will also explain you that. Okay, I'm going to present something here. Let me know when my screen pops up. Okay. So, do you see my screen?
Yeah, Dinesh.
How about now?
Yeah, it is visible. Yes.
Okay. Okay, great. Yes. So what I'm going to do is need to let me do one thing and turn off my video so that it's better explaining. Okay. So yeah, I think you guys still see my screen.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Okay. So before even jumping in, I would like to emphasize that our company is Dream Technology. So this is a company that Meenakshi Priya is my sister. She's my younger sister. So we both kind of put it together. So she has a proper industrial background. She has a proper software enterprise background. So she has 15 years of experience in the software industry. She has worked in numerous places like CTS, Deloitte. She carries a huge value from the software industry. Whereas me is an opposite. I'm a researcher. I have not worked in any of the companies so far. So I did my undergrad in Vellore Engineering College, which is VIT now. Then moved on to do my master's in U of I Chicago. So wherein, you know, I started exploring my passion, which is artificial intelligence and human-computer interaction. There I learned a lot about artificial intelligence and human-computer interaction. Thereafter, I went on to do my research in that for 3-4 years. Then I came back to India and started exploring, you know, different fields. After which, in 2016, me and Meenakshi joined together to start this company. That's the overall small brief intro about the company, how it all got started. And if you see the very important part in the logo itself, like you see that there is a very significant Tamil letter. So you'll get to see A. So we wanted to emphasize that what is the significance of A in terms of mathematics and in terms of the whole existence of Tamil. So that's the reason we have this A as our logo. And if you see, if you have a closer look into it, you'll see that there is a Fibonacci series that's running inside it. So we are saying R is Nexus' own form. So that's a simple introduction about our logo. I just want to emphasize this because we come from a Tamil background and we honor Tamil and its privileges in every aspect that we do. Okay. So about us, it's an AI company. It's based in Chennai and we believe in enlightenment. So when I say enlightenment, so the way we take our students, I will say students because initially, you know, when we recruit, we take them as students, we'll give them training for 3 to 6 months. And after the 3 to 6 months, we will make them know, do the actual work. We'll put them into projects. Okay. So, and whatever the number of people we have so far, we have a total of 32 people. In the last 4 years, we have built it from, you know, from 4 people to 32 people. And all those 32 people are, you know, freshers who graduated fresh out of diploma, engineering. We took them as freshers. We trained them. And so far, we didn't have like even one single attrition. So whoever came in, stayed with us, they are focused. It's like, you know, we always used to say, we are a family. Okay. So this is, again, about me. I did my MS in HCI and data mining, New York, Chicago. Founder. My main focus is AI and full stack. So I am a full stack engineer. Basically, if you ask me to develop any mobile applications, any web applications, I'm very well versed with that. Okay. This is my Twitter handle, @artist. And then these are the few ads that we have developed in the past, Vidi and Identity. I'll tell you what those ads are. And I've been a founder in other things also, Dream Applications, Dream Cards, and Dream Studio. So today, the major focus will be, you know, I'll be explaining you about AI. And what I'll suggest is, you know, in today's topic, I like to, you know, divide it into two categories. One, I'll give you a gist about, you know, what AI is and basic introduction, basic. And then I'll tell you one more important factor, how to learn, okay, how you can really start coding. I know people in the first year will always have this, you know, difficulty. They don't know how to go about coding, how to, you know, take up a problem and then solve it, how to, you know, go about doing things in AI itself. Okay, that is something I like to, you know, walk you through today. Okay. So AI is all about data. If you look closely into it, people will say, hey, artificial intelligence, this, you know, a robo can, you know, act as a human. But underneath that, the real fact is AI is all about data. So for example, if you think, okay, AI as a kid, okay, whatever the kid is getting to learn, okay, that's what the kid will, you know, happen to deliver. Okay, so if you know, impose few things on the kid and then make it learn that particular skill, the kid will. That has no machine learning in it. Spam detection classifier is there. Okay. And then you guys will always use Facebook, your Instagram, and your mobile phones. If you take up your phone and then put a selfie, you see that, no, the focus is on the faces, right? the face detection, that's itself an AI. It's most of your speeches, the computer vision, the self-driving cars, which you are hearing again and again. And when you go and hit Google, you'll get to see few ads that's coming on the side. All those ads are no artificial intelligence only. And your antivirus that you run in your computer, how does it detect a particular virus now in the present state? It uses artificial intelligence. Okay, the weather forecast that you get to hear every day in TV, in radio, or even in some of the weather channels, right? So all those are like AI. And the very important right now, the Swiggies, the Zomatos, the Amazons, the Flipkarts that you use, when you go in there, it will tell you this is the recommended product for you. And the YouTube, if you go in there, this says, okay, this is the recommended video for you based upon your what? Your past history of viewing, your past purchase history, right? So all those recommendation engines are running, some part of it is running machine learning algorithms, okay? Okay, so on the gist, if you see, machine learning has three types of learning. One is supervised, another one is unsupervised, and the third one is the reinforcement learning, okay? The world now is spending most of its time in supervised learning. It's yet to explore the unsupervised and the reinforcement learning part. We are still in SMC. Supervised learning, we have come far away. We have done a lot of things in supervised learning, but have a few skills. And then you will be able to adapt these skills to a different, for example, there may be a sports team leader. Okay, he may be very, very good at sports. He has a few knowledge about how to manage a particular team member in a game. Okay, the same knowledge, this particular person who becomes a software team lead will apply that and then be able to produce a better result. Okay, this sort of meta learning is where reinforcement comes in. Okay, reinforcement is all about letting you do the things. It's called experience learning. Reinforcement is called experience learning. See, in an experience, what do? Okay, from whatever you get to know from the previous past, you will adjust your future and the present, right? That's the experience learning. That's what happens in reinforcement learning. So these are three broad categories of learning that's present in machine learning. So again, these are all I'm going to show you a few flow diagrams. Just hang on with these flow diagrams. Okay, this is to give an explanation of what is really happening inside. Okay, so the raw data is coming in. Again, data can be anything. It can be a banking data. It can be a data from user viewing history from YouTube. It can be data from user purchase history from Amazon. It can be data from user purchase eating history from Swiggy. Okay, all those can be a raw data. Okay, what really happens, there is something called feature extraction. People will extract the features. They will focus on what is important and what is not important for the problem in hand. Okay, and based on the features that's extracted, we'll train a model. See, right now it may look like XYZ. When I say labels, when I say features, when I say model, you'll not understand anything, but these are all the three important factors that's part of creating an AI architecture. Okay, we'll get into the details. Okay, so once we have the data, that data we need to extract only the features that is of interest, and based upon the data that is of interest, we'll train a model. I'll tell you what training is all about. Okay, we'll train a model, and then once a model is trained, we'll bring in new data and then try to predict, okay, whether the labels are correct or not. Okay, it's like how to train a child. Okay, you'll basically throw the letters on the floor. Okay, it's A. What is this letter? The child will say it's B. Okay, sometimes it will say instead of saying C, it may say D or E. Okay, you will correct the child, telling okay, this is not C, this is E. Okay, this is not D, this is C. Okay, this correction and everything happens here as part of training. You tell that. Okay, we'll jump into this. This is supervised. What you do, you give the training data where you also label it. Okay, you are giving the child all those letters and alphabets and then telling this is A, this is B, this is C, this is D. Okay, you also label it, and based on the label, you'll train the child. Okay, once the child learns it, you'll ask it to predict whether what this letter is. Okay, that's the except there is one data which is not behaving similarly. Okay, we should be able to recognize the pattern that now most of the data belongs to this category and this particular set of data is not belonging to this category. It's about finding the patterns that exist in the data and based on the pattern, okay, clustering the data. Okay, that is what unsupervised learning is all about. That's what is depicted here. Okay, next is reinforcement learning. Okay, I told you before, reinforcement learning is a special type of learning where you learn through experience. Okay, if you do something and then you do it right, you will be rewarded. If you do something, you do it wrong, you will be punished. Based upon the reward and the punish, okay, this model will adjust itself and then make sure it achieves maximum reward. So what really happens? When can a model get a maximum reward? Only when you keep giving reward. When will you keep giving reward? Only when it does the things right. Okay, so the prediction becomes correct. So that's how it is. So in all your gaming engines that is going to come in the future and that you have now, your Xbox, your PS5s, your Second Life, and all the gamings that you use so far, Unity 3D games built in VR games built, all those use this reinforcement learning. Okay, a subject in a game automatically learns how to counter an attack. Okay, how does it learn? It learns based on experience upon which it is given reward and it's punished. Okay, that's reinforcement learning. And a good example is all your gaming engines is where right now it's deployed. Okay, so if you see, this is again kind of a categorization. Machine learning is categorized into supervised and unsupervised. And in supervised, we have no classification, regression. And in unsupervised, we have something called clustering. If you see, these are all, whatever you see on the top are all machine learning models. And what you see at the bottom is neural networks. Neural networks are basically the deep learning models. Okay. If you want to achieve greater accuracy, you want to use neural networks. If you want to achieve lesser accuracy, you want to use deep learning models. Okay. For lesser accuracy, machine learning models is enough. And when will you go for machine learning models and when will you go for deep learning models? This is the exact question most of the people will have. Okay, when you have a less amount of data and your accuracy, you don't need a much higher accuracy. Okay, it's better to restrict and the cost to production is very less. Okay, you don't have much money to spend. Okay, it's better to stop your research and your application using the algorithms. Okay, if you have too much of data, if you have lots and lots of data, okay, and you have enough budget to spend on, okay, and accuracy is of prime importance to your problem in hand, neural networks is the way to go. So the order of magnitude of data increases, we will reach neural networks as the best choice. Okay, there are so many classification, regression, and clustering. When I say classification is all about you saying, okay, I have this data. Can you tell me whether this particular, it can be your housing price prediction. Okay. For example, in terms of loan, right? If I give an user detail, like I'll say, this is the age, this is the company he's working on, this is his past history of loan payment, this is the regular expenditure and everything. I should be able to classify that user whether he is eligible for loan or not. Similarly, for insurance, whether this particular is eligible for insurance or not. If an email comes based upon my past record, I should be able to tell whether the email is a spam or is a good email. Okay, that's the classification part. Okay, next is, let's say you want to predict a price of house, of a stock, of anything per se. It can be a product, okay. From the past history, if I tell, okay, this is the product, this product is made of all these ingredients and this is coming from this place and this year it has this price and this year it has this price. I should be able to calculate a prediction that particular process called regression. Okay. And now the final thing is clustering. I already explained you what is. Okay. Clustering is about based upon the patterns of existence. For example, from your browsing history, I can say, okay, this particular person has this taste. It can be the taste of movie. It can be the taste of pages that he's looking at. It can be the taste of blogs that he's reading and everything. Okay, that part of clustering uses together is called unsupervised learning. Okay, that's what clustering is all about. So before even jumping into deep learning, I would like to pause here and then ask you again the same question. Am I audible and were you able to follow? Okay, that's the face is right because I don't want to go too fast. I know I can accomplish this whole thing in the next 20 minutes, whatever I've got left. Okay, but before that, I want to hear it from you saying, okay, whether it's right or wrong. So, shall I continue?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's a nice
topic. Okay, sir, I'll continue. Okay, so I'm continuing with the presentation. So, since now we have seen what is machine learning, okay, but deep learning is also part of machine learning. You saw this, right? Where we are merging two neural networks. Neural networks is what deep learning is all about. Deep neural networks. That's why it's called deep learning. Okay, DNN. Okay. Okay. Deep neural networks or deep learning. Okay. See, when you don't apply algorithms, see, all these are algorithms, support vector machines, linear regressions, k-means, okay, Gaussian mixer, naive Bayes, and all those are algorithms, okay? Those are proper algorithms, like how you do your, for example, for first year, you would have done few sorting algorithms, right? Similarly, these are all pure basic algorithms. There is nothing, you know, black box in it. You know what's happening in the algorithms, okay? Okay. Now, in order to understand neural network, you need to understand what a neuron is, okay? What exactly is this neural network? Your brain is what this neural network is all about. Okay, your brain is made out of neurons that are connected to each other as a network. Okay, your brain is made of what? Neurons that are connected to each other as a network. That's why it's called neural network. Okay, and what we're trying to do here in AI as a whole is trying to mimic the human intelligence. How can you mimic the human intelligence? Only if you mimic the human brain, which acts as the core for human intelligence, you'll be able to mimic the human intelligence, right? So that's the reason the scientists in the past era, even this thing is going on for the last 70, 80 years, okay? They have started exploring how exactly brain is working so that I can make a machine that will also have brain, okay? Our quest to understand that part is what deep learning is all about. Okay, for that you need to understand what a neuron is. Okay, this is how a neuron actually looks. Okay, a neuron has something called cell body, and then dendrites, axon, okay, and then synapse. Okay, these are all the four important parts. We don't have to talk much about the myelin sheath and the action potential. These four important parts: the cell body, the dendrites, the axon, and the synapse. Okay, the cell body is where I'll tell you what happens in a brain. Okay, when you touch something that is hot, you'll feel it's hot. You'll take your hand immediately back, right? Okay, what really happening there is when you touch something, the signal of that heat is sent to your brain, where a particular set of neurons. When I say fire, see, all our body is made out of electrical pulses. The signal that we receive in your brain is still an electric pulse, actually. Okay. So when I look at something, I will be able to recognize, hey, this is a light bulb. How do I know that's a light bulb? Because a particular set of neuron in my brain is firing when that particular set, for example, A1, T1, and F1. If these three comes up, it's a light bulb. Okay. This particular set of neuron firing is what tells me it's a light bulb. Okay, for that to fire, this cell body, what a cell body does, it accumulates all the signals that it's receiving through the dendrites. Okay, what is really happening? It accumulates all the signals that it's receiving through the dendrites. So what happens in a cell body? Accumulation of signals. Okay, if that accumulation of signal is more than a particular threshold, that's what we call as firing of neuron. Okay, that's what we call as firing of neuron. Okay, how does the signal pass? The signal passes through something called axon. Okay, and how much signal is passed to the next neuron in the network? How much signal is passed to the next neuron in the network depends upon the synapse. Okay. See, what are all the things we have? We have an accumulation region. We have a conducting region. Okay. We have a region to pass the signal. And we have a way to, okay, send how much ever signal we want to the next neuron in place. Okay. See, in mathematics, right? Not in mathematics, generally in life. Okay. When you want to expand something and when you want to contract something, what do you do? What you do is basically you multiply it with a number. Okay. Multiplying something with a number, what will it do? It will either shrink it or expand it. That's all a multiplication can do. Right? If it's, let's say, I have two chocolates. I am multiplying, okay, number 5 with it. What happened? Now the chocolates has expanded to 10. Okay. I have two chocolates. I am multiplying 0.5 with it. What happens? Now the chocolate has shrinked to 1. So what does a multiplication do? It either expands or shrinks. Okay. That's exactly the purpose of synapse. Okay. A synapse is what does that? Synapse takes care of how much signal to give to which connection. Okay. How does it give that? It does the multiplication that. If the multiplier is higher, it's going to be higher signal getting passed to the next neuron. Okay. If the multiplier is lesser, the lesser signal is going to get passed to the next neuron. Okay. This is a biological neuron. Okay. Now we'll take a look at artificial neuron. A single artificial neuron is called perceptron. What is it called? It's called perceptron. Okay. See, whatever I am telling you is the basics. I hear that you people are from first year and you have just finished your first year. And this is the right place to start for the first year students. Okay. If you have few experience, if you have already gone through in AI, the things that I will take you through will be totally different. Okay. This is the most basics that you can get in terms of deep learning. Okay. Okay. A single neuron, whatever you saw here is a biological neuron. Whatever you are seeing here is an artificial neuron. Okay. What is this? It's called artificial neuron. Basically, this particular subject is called ANN in terms of deep learning. Okay. So when it comes to deep learning, this single neuron is called perceptron. See, inputs. Here, we get the inputs through the dendrites, right? We get the inputs through the dendrites. Okay, here we are getting the inputs. Okay, and then how much input is got? How much input we are getting? Who decides how much input we are getting? The synapse decides it. Okay, what did I tell you? The synapse is nothing but a multiplier, right? That is what this weight is all about. And this particular part is called cell body. Okay, what does the cell body do? It accumulates all the inputs. Okay, the cell body accumulates all the inputs. Okay, that's why here we have summation. What is an accumulation? See, we have, assume this as water pipes. Okay, assume all these are water pipes. Okay, what happens here? All the water that comes in the pipe gets added, right? That's why we have the summation. Okay. And we are telling when it reaches a particular threshold, fire. When it reaches a particular threshold, fire. So that's the reason we have this function. This is called activation function. Okay. Now, this is the actual comparison between an actual neuron and a perceptron. Okay. A cell body is where we do the summation and the multiplier. Okay. Here, this is the input and this is the synapse. What does the synapse do? It multiplies. See? It multiplies W0, which is basically in terms of neural network, it's called weight. Okay, it's multiplying that weight, and then in cell body, all the weights are getting accumulated, and finally, it passes through the activation function. Based upon the activation function, either it will fire. That's the exact neuron and a perceptron. Okay, and in terms of simple neural network, you'll get to see this. Okay, this one single neuron is what you saw here. This whole thing is this one single neuron, this part. Okay. Now, explain what is a simple neural network and what is a deep neural network? Okay. A simple neural network is the one where you have no input layer. The input layer is the one that has only the inputs, x1, x2, x3. Hidden layer is where the actual neurons are there. Okay. And the output layer. The output layer is where you get to see the predictions. Okay, this is a simple neural network. Okay, this is a deep neural network. A deep neural network is the one we have lot of hidden layers. You see, there is 4 hidden layers here. Okay, and this is called fully connected neural network because if you see one input is connected to all the neurons. A neuron in one layer is connected to all the neurons in the other layer. Okay, this is called fully connected neural networks. So these are called layers. There are like numerous type of neural networks where we change the layers, we change the number of connections, we change the connection between the layers, we change one layer connecting the next immediate layer and then connecting to the other layer. All those are basically changing the way the structure is. But end of the day, the bare minimal neural network is what this is all about. We spoke about machine learning and now we are speaking about deep learning. What exactly is the difference between machine learning and deep learning? Okay, see, as I told you, machine learning is all about algorithmic. Okay, in an algorithm, you need an expert, okay, for you to figure out what are all the features that are important, particular problem in hand, and based upon the features that is given by an expert, we will decide, okay, what parameters to give to the model. Okay, but whereas in a deep learning, there is no expert requirement is needed. All we do is they will take the inputs, give it to the deep learning network, which does both the feature extraction and the classification, and it will output whether it's a car or not. Okay, this is the bare minimal difference between a machine learning and a deep learning. Okay. Now, since I have told you about machine learning, I have told you about deep learning. See, as a 101, it's always good to know the history of it. Okay, how it all started. Okay, see, this is how it all started. This is not a like you see it. It's not been there for the last 5 years. Not there for last 10 years. It's been in existence from 1960s. Okay, 1960s is when Rosenball came up with something called perceptron. Okay. From there on, it had a lot of winters. When I say winters, the real problem with artificial intelligence was when it came in, it had this bubble effect. Everybody was going gaga about artificial intelligence. And then it dipped. It totally lost its place, okay, during the 80s. And then in the 90s, it had few places. And then during the early 2000s, it was totally down. Okay, people were totally focusing on machine learning and algorithmic based approach because they thought neural networks is a complete failure. Okay, the reason they thought that is because during the early 2000s, we don't have much data to deal with. We don't have the computing power that we have now to do all the required calculations. Okay, and it's during this decade, the last decade, that is the 2010 to 2020 is when artificial intelligence and the deep learning as such has got its place. Okay, that too exactly after 2012, a researcher from Google, Fei-Fei Li, came up with a very super paper called ImageNet. Okay, that paper, which is not even algorithmic change in AI, the paper had a very significant importance of how she collected millions of images and trained a neural network. That neural network is that's something that's been invented some 40 years back. The algorithm was the same, but what was different is her approach to give millions of data to train the network. Before that, whatever the people has trained were tens and thousands of data, but when she tried with millions of data, that too properly segmented annotated data, okay, she was able to produce amazing results that none of the machine learning algorithmic based approach can't even come closer. She came to accuracy level of 90% at the time, which is like mind-blowing because most of the machine learning algorithms that were doing were 60 to 70%, 20% increase. But now every year on year, the amount of increase that we are getting in terms of neural network accuracy is like 0.02, 0.1, 0.2. That's the accuracy we are gathering. That is also we are trying to achieve the human intelligence in terms of recognition. Okay, this is the history, small history that you see. Okay, often I get to ask this question. Okay, from lots and lots of students. See, I always interact with a lot of students. So I know what a student thinks and what their difficulty is. That's the reason I have this slide. Okay. Often I get to ask, okay, what exactly is neural network? How can I get into artificial intelligence? How can I learn deep learning and everything? Okay. So see, And very important, how can I become a data scientist? And what exactly is data science? So if you look closely, people will say, hey, you are a computer science graduate. Hey, well and good, you can become a data scientist. No, actually. Okay. See, to become a data scientist, you need a mix of all the things that's on the screen. You need to know a bit of computer science. You need to have a very good understanding about math and stats. You need to have software development skills, machine learning algorithms. And best of all, okay, you need to have the domain knowledge. When I tell domain knowledge, what does it mean? You, whatever the problem in hand, for example, you want to identify using AI, you want to identify whether a particular loan application, okay, is a legit application or not, whether the particular loan applier will become a defaulter or not. If you want to identify that single piece of it, okay, you need to have the knowledge, the domain knowledge about, you know, how the business is carried, how the insurance business does things in terms of, you know, analyzing a loan application. You have to, you know, replace, you know, tons and tons of tens and thousands of humans who actually does this work manually, okay, into an artificial intelligence. So you need to imbibe that knowledge of humans into the artificial intelligence. Okay, so that's where the domain knowledge is very, very important. Other than that, maths and statistics is very important, because only if you understand the underlying math, okay, you will be able to, you know, make sense of the neural networks. See, if you want to, you know, run a particular network and produce some results, you don't need to know any of this, okay? But if you want to really do some good work, okay, that's when all this is needed, okay? Okay, so this is the first thing. What you need to learn? You need to know a bit of computer science, a bit of maths, a bit of domain knowledge, okay, to become a data scientist. Okay, next is, okay, what is the language that's preferred to learn neural networks, to learn or code in neural networks? Okay, always remember, for people in computer science, the only way to learn and only way to say that you have learned something is to code. Okay, the only way to learn is to code. Those are all the three secrets to learn, okay, for computer science students, is to code. If you have a concept and if you can code that concept, that means you have learned that concept. Okay, let it be anything, okay? So this is the trend. So I usually ask people to, you know, use Python for machine learning and data science. The reason being, Python has lots and lots of packages and it's easy to get started, and you'll find help and a lot of resources for you to get started with deep learning and machine learning if you are using Python, okay? And if it's machine learning, there is a beautiful package called scikit-learn. It's an open source library. You can use that library. And again, I'm telling you, the present world has very much evolved, okay? For example, if you guys are like from first year, you would have done some C programming, right? I would have done like ash include stdio.h. You'll never know what's really happening in stdio.h, but you'll know the concept. You'll know, okay, in order to do the input and the output, I need stdio.h. Okay, but you don't know how it was coded, what's in there. Similarly, because that's a library that you're using. Similarly, in order to know, get started with machine learning, I would say you better use scikit-learn. Scikit-learn has all the algorithms implemented. Okay, all you need to do is like call a particular function, how you are calling scanf in your C program, how you are calling printf in your C program, but you'll never know how that was coded, how scanf was coded, how printf was coded. Similarly, in scikit-learn, there are like all these classification algorithms, this clustering algorithms, this regression algorithms, this dimensional reduction algorithm. All this is available as a single function. For example, if I want to do k-means clustering, all I need to do is like k-means of, I'll pass the data. In return, it will tell me the class that it belongs to. Okay, similar. That's the reason I'll mostly ask students to start with scikit-learn if they want to know, get started with machine learning. Okay, next up is, again, the next question is, there is lots and lots of deep learning frameworks that's available in the market. Which is the best one to take? Okay, again, don't go with, you know, your instinct. It's better to see where the crowd is, where the mass is, where you can get help, where there's a lot of libraries that are available, which you can use and make, you know, things faster. Okay, if you look at the TensorFlow, and now this is a bit old data, but now PyTorch. TensorFlow and PyTorch are the two important packages that have, you know, all this information. Okay, that has lots and lots of community backing, and it's easy to get started. You can find there is a lot of packages, there is a lot of functions which you can use in your project, okay? TensorFlow and PyTorch, okay? So in terms of frameworks and tools, okay, these are the five important frameworks and tools we use in our company as part of AI, okay? Python, Keras, TensorFlow, Scikit-learn and PyTorch. Okay, TensorFlow and PyTorch are the deep learning frameworks that we use. Keras is something that built on top of TensorFlow and PyTorch. Okay, Scikit-learn is the machine learning framework that we use. And whatever we do in this four is been coded only in Python so far. We deal with everything in Python. Okay, so that's the frameworks and tools that we use. And if you want to get started, these five things are the best things to get started with. Okay, and as I told you before, okay. How to start, where to know, start, and what to study. Okay, you need a basic software engineering knowledge, a database, data warehouse, statistics, linear algebra, calculus, programming, analytic mindset, and you need a scientific rigor, and then most important of that, domain knowledge. When you have all this, you can get started. And now the world is totally different. Okay, you can get personal trainings, and you can get a lot of things you can learn from your professor. At the same time, there is a lot of massive online courses that are available. Okay, you can also learn from that. You can learn from that, take it to your professor. Okay, ask them to know why. If you don't understand something, ask them to explain that, get it clear. That's the best way to learn in today's world. Okay. And as Meenakshi explained, these are all the few services that we offer as part of AI. Okay, and okay, this is our AI product, Identity. If you ask, like, what have we done as part of Identity? So as part of AI, so we have this particular set of products that is under the brand Identity. So it's actually, if you see, it starts with an I and ends with an I. We always used to say Identity is as couple of eyes, like a real human, so it can identify anything. Okay, so using Identity, we have developed attendance registration, we have developed eKYC and video KYC, like how we do your banking. Okay, how you can enroll a particular user in banking, in insurance, and in any sector per se, using eKYC and video KYC. We have a solution for that. And document digitization, any document, if you have it, that can be digitized from any format, from bill books to actual Excel. Okay, retail analytics. Okay, we have enabled CCTV, AI-enabled CCTV cameras that will analyze, okay, your shop sales and everything using just the videos that's captured from the shop. Okay, virtual try-ons, like how you are people, you would have seen something in Lenskart, right? You can put your glasses, whatever that's available, you can choose the glass and then see how it looks on your face. Okay, that's the virtual try-on part. We have solution for all this. Okay, and we have a very good dashboarding tool called Viri. And again, you see, it carries this Tamil name called Viri. Viri is a dashboarding tool. If you give it the data that we have, it will put those data as charts and tell you what. Analyze the data and give you feedback saying, okay, what is the data and what is the pattern is following and everything. Okay. Okay. Now on to the most important part. I'll take another 5 minutes. Okay. I'll close this. Okay. To the students and also the faculties, if they are in the session. See, the most sessions that I give, the talks that I give in most of the colleges here in and around Chennai and also elsewhere. Okay. I see this problem that people from the academia are not using the perfect set of tools. Okay, see, for you to become a very good skilled worker, okay, what is very important? A good set of tools. A worker with a good set of tools is already off skilled. Okay, is already off way in a skill. Okay, so it's very, very important. But what I don't see in academia is these tools. They give no lot of knowledge to the students. They give no lot of theories to the students, but not the tools. Even now in the academia, they don't use IDEs. Okay. So these are all the big set of tools for you to get started with AI. Language, please use Python. IDE, use Visual Studio Code. There is this Visual Studio Code, which is open source and it's free. You can download whatever you code. Please code using Visual Studio Code. And if it's a research which you want to take it one step at a time, please use Jupyter Notebooks. Okay. Always and always try to remember, use some kind of a version control, Git. This is something even I see professors from most of the reputed institutions are not aware of. So I'm just emphasizing here, please use Git. We need a version control. Students should start using version control right from first year so that they know what version control is. No, they know how the software industry is working, why it is important, why they should be able to collaborate with others using version controlling. Okay, this is a version control and collaboration tool, Git. And then test cases. The most important and the single most important that India as such as a whole is lacking is this. Okay, whenever a product is created, from the Indian community and the rest of the world community, there is a big difference. The Indian community are focused on the part to get the product out, whereas the international community is focused on the test part of the product. They want to test the product and make sure the product is perfect in all aspects, then focus on delivering the product. So test cases, test-driven development is one of the most important place where I will say the academy are to focus on. There is something called unit testing that is people should be aware of. These are all the four things, of which very important is the VS Code, the Jupyter Notebook, and the Git. Try to use these tools. The best way to learn is not through books. The best way to learn is not through completing lots and lots of courses. The best way to learn is to come up with a problem statement. Have a problem statement. Have a problem in hand. Take that problem. Search in Google how that problem was solved so far. The problem can be as simple as this: housing price prediction. As simple as, can I predict my marks the next year? Given my track record of my past marks. Can I predict, the disease in the world next year? Can I predict from the patient data? Can I predict whether the patient has corona or not? Can I predict, will there be a lockdown next year also? These are all problem statements. Another problem statement can be like this. I have some ancient books. Can I take the knowledge out of the ancient books and given a set of symptoms, will I be able to tell the medicine for the symptoms? All those things are problem statements. Take a problem statement. It can be any problem statement. Simply, this learning is not with respect to AI, with respect to anything. Take a problem statement, search in Google. Like how you search for movies, like how you search for torrents, right? Search in Google. Once you search in Google, you'll know where, what have been done in that particular problem. Now, go to GitHub. If you are not familiar with GitHub, please, after this session, take your time. Go and explore what is a GitHub. Learn about that. Go and search in GitHub. See whether there is any code base that is present, which someone has already developed for the problem at hand. In present world, I have told you, think of any problem. Someone would have solved it some way or the other. But it may not be the optimized. It may not be suiting to India. It may not be suiting to your community. It may not be suiting to your college. It may not be suiting to you. But a partial of this problem, like a variation of the problem, would have been solved by someone. Search in GitHub. Download that code. Try to execute.